Hi, everyone. This is Dr. David Bluemke in Madison, Wisconsin. This is the first installment of the September 2018 issue. A few comments before we get going, and also a major change for this week's podcast. First, what is in the September issue? One article you might want to look at, an extended editorial about pacemakers and implanted devices versus safety in MRI. I asked three cardiologists to write this article. Why? The editorial is based on a major article in the New England Journal of Medicine by the same authors. It was published at the end of 2017. The article title is Safety of MRI in Patients with Cardiac Devices. The New England Journal has great articles, but this particular study needs to be read by radiologists. The first author is a good friend of mine from prior days at Johns Hopkins, Dr. Saman Nazarian. Dr. Nazarian and his colleagues have always worked closely with the MRI team in radiology. We put an MRI scanner right next to their offices in the cardiology department. It was very convenient for patients and physicians. The electrophysiologists could consult and observe patients in the MRI scanner with electronic devices, and an MRI scanner 10 feet away from their offices. This allowed us to study very complex cardiac patients. In the New England Journal article, the authors described their experience performing 2,130 MRI scans in more than 1,500 patients with devices. About half had pacemakers, and half had implanted defibrillators, or ICDs. Of the more than 2,000 MRI scans, only 5 MRI scans were not completed. There were no serious complications. For example, in one case, the MRI stopped due to severe artifacts on the scan. In another case, the patient had a lot of PVCs. The main point of the article, patients with ICDs and pacemakers can safely undergo MRI in many cases in most situations. The ICDs and pacemakers were not specifically labeled to be MRI compatible. Instead, the Johns Hopkins protocol was 1. Evaluate the patient, 2. Evaluate the cardiac device, 3. Plan monitoring and MRI scan parameters. There is now considerable evidence that MRI can be safely performed with these legacy cardiac devices. I recommend you read the article in the radiology issue in September for a summary. Hopkins has been doing this since 2003. One interesting note, why did this start at Hopkins in the first place? The credit goes to a professor of cardiology, Dr. Henry Halperin. Dr. Halperin is a wonderful physician. He is an electrophysiologist. He makes his living in cardiology by stimulating arrhythmias in humans. Then he makes burns in the heart to prevent those electrical patterns from spreading. To him, a minor incident in the MRI scanner is normal, like extra traffic on his drive to work. But I would say he has a skeptical nature. He asks a lot of questions. But he has one more characteristic. Before medical school, he was an electrical engineer. People who have multidisciplinary backgrounds can often leverage those backgrounds and innovate. Around 2003, Dr. Halperin approached me. He said he did not really believe pacemakers were so dangerous in the MRI scanner. He had already tested many of his devices at night in the MRI scanner in dogs. Nothing was happening to the dogs. No ripping of the pacemaker out of the chest, no burns in the heart. So, why so much concern in humans? 15 years later, Dr. Halperin's initial ideas continue to be right. Also, manufacturers continue to improve the cardiac devices. Think of any electrical device in your home. If it is 15 years old, you might as well throw it out. The electric circuits are outdated and require lots of power. Similar advances have taken place with cardiac devices. Next, a very nice change for today. I have a guest in the recording studio. Dr. Catherine Fowler is here with me. Dr. Fowler is this year's prestigious awardee from the RSNA in radiology journalism. Dr. Fowler received the Eiler Award from the RSNA, allowing her to receive 2 weeks of training with me in Madison. In addition, she spent 2 days in Oak Brook at the RSNA with our publication staff. And she was in Vermont with Dr. Jeff Klein, learning about publication in radiographics. Dr. Fowler is very well known in our field. She is an associate editor for abdominal imaging for this journal. Most recently, she has been at the Mallinckrodt Institute of Radiology at WashU. Katie, welcome to our podcast. Tell us a little more about your background and your radiology practice.
Thank you, David. I'm really pleased to be here and to help on these podcasts. I'm currently in the process of moving to the University of California in San Diego, where I'll be an associate professor in radiology. My primary clinical specialty is abdominal imaging, and my research focuses more on liver imaging with MRI and hepatocellular carcinoma.
Katie, I'm really glad you're here. You were able to attend our editorial board retreat last week. Also, we had 34 people at an RSNA-sponsored meeting, the Editors Forum. You had a crash course on scientific publishing and radiology. Most importantly, you have helped me a great deal on these podcasts. Ready to move to these?
Absolutely. Let's start.
Our first two articles this week are both about contrast agents. For MRI, the main topic right now is retention of gadolinium in the brain. For CT, an important ongoing topic is that of contrast reactions and how to minimize them. The short title of our first article is Gadolinium in Cerebrospinal Fluid, CSF, after administration of a gadolinium MR contrast agent in humans. The first author is Dr. Florian Berger. The article is from the University of Zurich in Switzerland. We know that after multiple GAD administrations, researchers have identified increased T1 signal in the basal ganglia in the brain. This seems to be more likely for the MRI contrast agents that have a linear structure. We have looked primarily at the brain signal. However, we would like to know how the GAD moves from the bloodstream to the brain tissue itself. So, Katie, what was the main purpose of this article? How did the authors try to answer their questions?
The main question is whether gadolinium crosses the blood-brain barrier after administration. Dr. Berger and colleagues analyzed CSF samples from patients who underwent enhanced MRI and then lumbar puncture, or LP, within 60 days. This was a retrospective analysis.
Okay. It is interesting that in this study, years later, the author's hospital had saved samples of the CSF from many patients. The investigators were able to match the lab records of patients who had lumbar puncture fluid samples with those who had a prior MRI with gadolinium. Katie, how many patients were able to be included?
The study cohort consisted of 60 CSF samples in 57 patients. About half were men. These were adult patients with an average age of 50 years.
Right. Adult patients who needed both MRI and lumbar puncture. What else about these patients?
Well, one interesting feature was the time between MRI and LP varied among patients. Some had LP immediately after the MRI. Others had LP up to 2 months later. We expect that any retained gadolinium would decrease over time. So the authors grouped the patients into three categories. The first group had an LP within 8 hours of MRI. A second group within 2 days. And the third group from 2 days to 2 months. They also had 24 control patients who had not undergone MRI for at least 1 year. As you might expect, patients who need both MRI and LP are not necessarily healthy. They had a wide range of disorders, from cancer to psychiatric. About half had abnormal CSF protein levels.
I see. It is a common issue with retrospective studies to have a range of patients. This introduces a lot of complexities, but is usually where we need to start. If the results of a retrospective study are interesting, we can next design a prospective study with better controls. Katie, tell us about the MRI exam.
These patients all had the contrast agent with the trade name Dotarem, or gadoterate. This is a macromolecular contrast agent. It was administered at normal dose, which is about 20 milliliters for a standard adult male. We do not usually associate Dotarem with gadolinium retention. In last month's August issue of Radiology, there is a nice study of Dotarem in a rat model. In animal models, high levels of GAD are injected. There was just trace amounts of Dotarem detected 3 or more months after the injection.
Okay, we are building upon prior results known in animals. So for the current study, what happens in humans?
First, gadolinium was detected in all CSF samples of patients who had undergone contrast-enhanced MRI. Second, gadolinium was not detected in any patients in the control group, except there were two control patients who had GAD MRI more than 1 year prior to the LP. These patients did have trace levels detected. Importantly, gadolinium in the CSF was cleared by 48 hours in most patients. The gadolinium detected after 48 hours was trace.
All right, thank you. This is a nicely done study. The authors used a convenient sample, but they had very good documentation of the patient's clinical history. They used mass spectroscopy to detect GAD in the CSF. We had prior animal models of the CSF that showed similar findings, and there were several prior studies that showed enhancement of CSF on MRI. But MRI signal itself is not specific. This seems to be one of the first human studies where the gadolinium atom was directly measured in CSF after the MRI. GAD was present in the CSF in patients with and without an intact blood-brain barrier. There were some patients with renal failure. Those patients had GAD in the CSF for a longer period of time. Otherwise, GAD clears out of the CSF by 48 hours, except for trace levels. Okay, Katie, I'd like to turn our attention to another article on contrast agents, but this time for CT. The first author is Dr. Sejin Park from Seoul National University in South Korea. The title is Immediate Mild Reactions to CT with Iodinated Contrast Media, Strategy of Contrast Readministration Without Corticosteroids. Katie, what's the background for this study?
Well, in our hospital and perhaps yours, we presume that a mild CT contrast reaction is only the first step. A first mild reaction could prime the pump, so to speak. Next time, the reaction could be worse. Most practices know about the American College of Radiology Manual on Contrast Media. On page 5 of the 2018 guide, we see the following statement. Patients who had a prior allergic reaction to contrast medium have about a 5-fold increased risk of developing a future reaction. And a prior allergic-like reaction to the same class of contrast medium is considered the greatest risk factor for predicting future adverse events. So, you might be surprised by this study, and it perhaps would not have been done in the United States.
I agree. Our routine, if the patient had any sort of even a mild reaction, they get the full course of corticosteroids and antihistamines. If steroids are not possible, we would opt for a non-contrast CT or an MRI. Many practices are very strict on these rules.
That's right. In this study, Dr. Park analyzed a large cohort of more than 1,000 patients with initial mild allergic-like reaction.
Katie, before we go further, remind us of the ACR definition of a mild contrast reaction.
Sure. According to the ACR contrast manual, a mild allergy-like reaction is limited hives or itchiness, limited skin edema. It also includes nasal congestion and sneezing or itchy throat, the sort of symptoms we associate with springtime hay fever. The authors did separately track GI symptoms such as nausea and vomiting, too. They had a hospital-wide system. If a patient had a mild reaction that had previously been entered into the system, the ordering physician would see a recommendation for premedication. The only premedication used in this study was an antihistamine, no steroids. The antihistamine was 4 milligrams of chlorpheniramine, also known as chlorphenamine. In the United States, this drug is present in many over-the-counter meds, such as Alarest or Tylenol cold and allergy tablets.
Okay, great. Let's go right to the results then. What happened with this regimen?
Well, there is one more critical aspect of the protocol that I need to mention first. Besides the antihistamine, the authors also switched the contrast agent for the second CT scan. All of the iodine contrast agents were low osmolar, non-ionic, similar to what we use in the United States. The hospital had made several changes over the years, and so they did have 6 different iodine contrast agents available over the study period. Overall, 1,241 patients had a prior CT scan with a mild reaction to contrast. These same patients underwent more than 3,500 additional CT scans with contrast. After these 3,500 scans, there were recurrent contrast reactions in 445 patients, which is about 13%. 99.3% were mild reactions. Only 3 were moderate, and none were severe.
It is very reassuring that none were severe. What happened when the contrast agent was changed or when antihistamines were given?
If there was no premedication and the same contrast agent was used, the recurrence rate was 31%. The most benefit was seen with the use of a different contrast agent along with an antihistamine. The recurrence rate decreased from 31% to 8% with this regimen. GI symptoms also decreased from 16% to about 2%.
Very nice result. This could help guide our practices. Similar to the ACR guidelines, this study shows that changing to a different low osmolar contrast agent is very helpful. That switch alone reduced the rate of recurrent reactions by about twofold. Adding an antihistamine plus changing the contrast agent resulted in about threefold reduction of reactions. Certainly, this is a less aggressive routine than might otherwise be used. Overall, the results are consistent with more mild contrast reactions from modern, low osmolar, and non-ionic CT contrast agents. Details of this study are in the September issue of Radiology. On to our second article for the September issue. The short title is Contrast-Enhanced CT for Diverticular Bleeding Before Colonoscopy, Prospective Multicenter Study. The first author is Dr. Umezawa and colleagues from Yokohama City University in Japan. This is paired with an editorial by Dr. Stuart Taylor from the Center for Medical Imaging at the University College of London. Katie, can you tell us about the clinical problem behind this paper?
Absolutely, David. First, we should give a little bit of background. Diverticular bleeding is a major cause of lower GI hemorrhage, accounting for about 40% of cases. Many cases resolve spontaneously, but an important minority may be severe or even life-threatening. Colonoscopy can be performed to identify the site of bleeding and to endoscopically treat the bleed. Colonoscopy, however, is an invasive procedure that requires colonic preparation. Also, it can be challenging to find the location of the bleed in about half of the patients. Prior retrospective studies have found that CT may provide value in locating the bleed. This allows more effective endoscopic treatment. A single small prospective study failed to show value of CT in this setting. This may have been because of too few patients included in that study.
Thanks for that background. Now, how did the authors study this problem in the current paper?
In the current study, Dr. Umezawa presents us with a multi-center prospective experience that included 10 centers in Japan. Their cohort was comprised of 442 patients presenting with hematochezia. 202 of them were diagnosed with colonic diverticular bleeding and were eventually included for analysis. The study design was a CT with contrast prior to colonoscopy. The contrast was delivered at a rate of 2 to 3 milliliters per second, and imaging was performed at a delay of 90 seconds. The CT exams were independently interpreted by a radiologist and a gastroenterologist at each site. Positive CT studies were those with contrast extravasation into the colon lumen. The reference standard was colonoscopy. Positive colonoscopy was defined as stigmata of recent hemorrhage, active bleeding, or diverticular disease without other source.
Interesting. So all patients had GI bleeding and then underwent a CT. Whether positive or negative, they then went to colonoscopy, potentially to treat their bleed endoscopically. What were the results?
Overall, the rate of positive CT, that is those with extravasation, was about 25% out of the 202 patients who presented with diverticular bleeding. The patients with positive CT had higher rates of positive colonoscopy than those with a negative CT. Time was a factor. When CT was performed within 4 hours of the bleed, the sensitivity for detecting the bleed was 65%. But if CT was performed after 4 hours, the sensitivity dropped to 33%. Overall, sensitivity of CT for detection of bleed was 58%. The specificity was 91%, and the specificity remained high no matter the timing.
Very promising. Dr. Umezawa's results validate prior retrospective cohorts. Katie, you have a lot of experience in GI imaging. What's your impression of these results?
I think there are some limitations and clinical considerations worth mentioning. First, the study was performed with venous phase of contrast only. In my institution, we would have used a three-phase CT. This includes non-contrast, arterial phase, and venous phase. That approach may improve sensitivity and specificity. Second, there was no evidence that colonoscopy performed in this setting would improve outcomes, such as rebleeding, duration of hospitalization, or transfusions.
Nice summary. The reviewers for this paper were concerned about the use of colonoscopy, whether this represents standard of care. What's your experience? Who sees these ED patients? GI physicians or interventional physicians?
I agree. In our institution, patients with acute bleed often do present to the ER. From there, the patients are often seen by an interventionalist, since the interventionalists are in the hospital and taking call. Historically, we would have done a tagged red blood cell scan, which never worked. More recently, we do perform the three-phase CT.
Excellent. To summarize, the authors showed that CT helps direct endoscopic therapy, but the positive yield of CT also seems like it would apply to interventional radiology as well. Imaging as soon as possible after the bleeding event seems critical. Overall, this is an interesting, well-done prospective study. Our final article for today is a thoracic topic. The short title is CT Classification of Pulmonary Perifissural Nodules, Reader Variability. This comes from Radboud University Medical Center in the Netherlands. Katie, can you give some clinical context behind this paper?
Sure, David. This study focuses on the ability of CT to classify small pulmonary nodules, in particular, to differentiate benign nodules from potentially malignant ones. Pulmonary nodules, as you know, are a major issue. We all encounter lots of incidental lung lesions. Also, CT is used as a screening test for patients at risk for lung cancer. For instance, people with a greater than 30 pack year smoking history. In either scenario, depending on size, nodules are followed by imaging or biopsied for diagnosis. Follow-up imaging intervals range from 3 to 24 months, depending on size. Some nodules, though, require no follow-up. These are the intrapulmonary lymph nodes. They are located by the pleura and the fissures. They also go by the name perifissural nodules, or PFN. Evidence suggests that intrapulmonary lymph nodes have no malignant potential. They require no follow-up. Radiologists need to recognize PFN and differentiate them from other pulmonary nodules that do need follow-up.
Nice overview. How did the authors study these perifissural nodules? What was the aim of the study?
The study aim was to find out how accurately and reliably radiologists can in fact recognize PFN. They used data and imaging from the NLST, that is, the National Lung Screening Trial. The authors took all malignant non-calcified solid nodules between 5 and 10 millimeters and added a random sampling of benign nodules. The final cohort consisted of 81 cancers and 278 benign nodules. Six experienced thoracic radiologists independently reviewed all of the cases. The readers were provided the following definition for PFN: lentiform, triangular or polygonal shape, location within 10 millimeters of pleura or fissure, morphology of extending linear densities.
So, if a nodule met all criteria, like triangular shape, within 10 millimeters of the pleura, and linear densities, it was labeled a PFN.
Correct. The authors also allowed for atypical PFN. These were nodules that met two of the three criteria. The authors evaluated reader agreement for nodule classification as either PFN, atypical PFN, and non-PFN.
Good. So the authors provided a distinct definition for PFN to be tested. How reliable were those criteria? What did they find?
I think that they were a little surprised by the results. The agreement for classifications of nodules as PFN versus non-PFN was moderate. the agreement for subclassification between typical and atypical PFN was only fair. Remember that PFN are supposed to be benign. But in this study, about 19% of PFN were actually cancer. The majority, 11 of 13 cancers, were located in the upper lobes.
So it sounds like radiologists need to be very careful about PFNs in the upper lobes?
Yes. Cancers were significantly larger and more likely to be in the upper lobe. Benign nodules were significantly more likely attached to a fissure or pleura.
The fact that almost 20% of cancers were labeled by experienced thoracic radiologists as benign is surprising. And agreement was not maybe what they were expecting to find. Did the authors explain why findings were so different?
Yes, this was discussed both in the paper and the editorial. Misclassification of cancer may be due to the expanded new criteria used in this study. Nodules only had to be within 10 millimeters of the pleura. And they allowed for atypical nodules, which only had to meet 2 of 3 criteria. These atypical nodules did seem to reduce their specificity. Finally, the cohort in this study had a lot of cancer, about 22%. Keep in mind, the incidence of cancer in the NLST trial was around 4%. So the pretest probability in this study of cancer was higher than you might even see in the NLST, and certainly higher than would be expected in a general population. Low agreement between readers may be due to the complex definition proposed by the authors. Also, as you pointed out, these readers were in fact experts. Experts can have strong opinions and may not always closely follow rigid definitions.
In his editorial, Dr. Jin Mugu nicely summarizes the study. He points out that between 7 and 21% of cancers were in fact perifissural or juxtapleural in location. Therefore, location near the pleura alone is not enough.
Yes, Dr. Mugu suggests greater reliance on the shape and morphology of the nodules. That is, lentiform, triangular, or polygonal shape, and smooth borders. The take-home point is to use caution when calling nodules PFN, especially if they are in the upper lobes.
That concludes this week's articles. I hope these podcasts were helpful to you. Until next time, this is Dr. David Bluemke and Dr. Catherine Fowler for the journal Radiology. Katie, it was fantastic that you could join us today.
Thanks, David. Very glad I could join.
Excellent. To our listeners, we hope you have a good rest of your week.